1997. Bill Clinton is about to begin his second term on January 20th. Jeff Buckley would be found dead from an accidental drowning, and the music scene was bigger than ever. After the fall of grunge and the rise of alternative came about, 1997 would end up being one of the most important years in that genre. Alternative was a new craze, and many bands came about because of this rise. Foo Fighters, Radiohead, Built to Spill, Arches of Loaf, Ween, and many, many more bands were creating some of the most memorable and creative albums of all time. But many of these bands suffered from one-hit wonders, and their other work is just completely forgotten. Ben Folds 5 suffered from this issue when they released their incredible album titled Whatever and Ever Amen. The album was successful, but at the cost of Brick, their most important single ever released. She's a brick and I'm drowning slowly. It smashed through all conventions and became a hit, but I think it's shocking how well it went for this band. The single will peak at 19 on US radio and 6 on the alternative chart, which is without mentioning how it did outside the US. Nevertheless, the album was a success and caused them to get a ton of publicity. However, people get bored and they lose interest in what once was. So they forget and move on to the next big thing, which is why Whatever and Ever is one of those albums that you will always find at your local music store that always sells for almost nothing, except the record, which is hard to get your hands on. Please do another pressing, Ben. I think that this album deserves more love than it gets, and as I realized that the 25th anniversary of the album was just around the corner, I thought that I should use what type of influence I currently have to preach about this album's existence and the group itself. They have certainly impacted my life and caused a lot of my friends to be angry at me because of how many times I mentioned them. I think they deserve all the love in the world though, because they created a mess. A beautiful and creative mess. But before we can get to the album, I think we should talk a little bit about the band and its history. Let's go back to 1993 in New York. Ben Folds had an idea. He wanted to make a band like no other. A trio that looked like jazz, but one that rocked. Just a bass, baby grand, and drums. His only problem was that, at the time, he was in New York, and hauling a baby grand wasn't really ideal. And he really didn't like the idea of playing with an electric one. He knew that New York had nothing left for him, and he had no future here. At some point, it occurred to him that Chapel Hill, North Carolina, was going through a huge music scene, and many bands like getting a lot of radio play. No real band was similar, and it seemed like a great opportunity for him to go to North Carolina, because no one has yet created a piano-based band, one that didn't have guitars.
Everybody's different. Nobody sounds alike.
The bands do have some things in common, though. Guitars are big.
You can't afford to buy a piano, so everybody plays guitar.
The people coming to town are record producers, music executives, and magazine writers. Most are quick to discover that the music here is as varied as the stores on Franklin Street.
It was then that Ben Folds had that iconic sitting on his suitcase moment that was in Don't Change Your Plans. It was either stay in New York and try to fix his already failing marriage and try to make ends meet, or move to North Carolina where he can pursue his idea. I think we know what he did. So yeah, Ben Folds would go back to North Carolina. It was here that Ben would inquire about a bassist in the area from his brother Chuck Folds. He would get in contact with Robert Sledge. Long story short, Ben and Robert were looking for a house to play in and found a small house in Chapel Hill, which they dubbed the Shit House. At the time, Ben would also run into Darren Jesse at a coffee shop. And not long after, Ben had what he was looking for. Ben Folds 5 was complete, and technically a temporary name, until it wasn't, because Ben needed a name for a gig, and he thought it was quote-unquote funny.
To approach it, you know, the whole reason we approached it with as a piano, bass, and drums, and have it really go out there and kick a lot of ass, we had to approach playing all the instruments differently. I mean, you couldn't get away playing drums like you could in a just a regular rock band.
There's also a certain freedom to throwing around styles and discovering and hearing them come out of your own music. It's just fun.
Now, I don't want to completely go through their whole history, because I want to make more Ben Folds 5 videos. So now, I will skip to 1995, the year that they released their debut album, Ben Folds 5. Around this time, they started calling themselves Punk Rock for Sissies and bullshitted a lot of interviews. And when I mean a lot, I mean a lot.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. We did. We were all in.
Hold on a second. Got it.
Thanks, D.
You're welcome.
As I was saying, we were all in bands, rock bands, things like that. And then Ben came down.
And my girlfriend was a cheerleader, and my father was the principal of the school, and we lived right next to the school in a mansion, and I had a Jaguar that I drove to school, so I was basically accepted. I was also the captain of the tennis team, and I was head of the Spanish club and the debate team. No, actually, I just worked at Hardee's and skipped most of my school.
Ben Folds 5 was raw, funny, and just so much fun. It sounded like three guys having a fun time making music. Robert's Fuzzbox became synopsis with the band and drive the band as this loud power that needed to exist. Darren's style of playing really suited the band, and he really always seemed to have a great emphasis on what he played. Ben's complex and catchy melodies made the band feel full, as if there were more members than just three. His writing style was funny and quirky and fit very well with the piano and nerd rock sound that they wanted. It really was a piano band that rocks. Ben Folds 5 had a sound and style like no other, and all the parts of the band equally made the sound so distinct and unique that if one were to leave, the sound would never be the same. Soon after the release of Ben Folds 5, it wasn't much of a major mainstream hit, but caught a large audience outside of the US in countries like Japan and Australia, with their singles like Underground or Philosophy. And although it wasn't much of a hit, it doesn't mean that it didn't catch the eyes from multiple record labels. And a bidding war would start. At the time, Ben Folds 5 was signed on with Carolina Records, a company who gained much popularity during the American punk, post-punk, and alternative rock era. Eventually, the band would settle on Sony 505, a subsidiary company of Epic Records, which was established not too long ago at the time. Ben Folds knew that all major record labels were at some point gonna put their foot down and make a lot of music decisions for the band. However, when they requested full music control, they were actually okay with this decision, and also gave Ben Folds 5 full control of their budget. So they were allowed to keep playing in the shitbox and upgrade the shit out of it. Another thing that they were allowed to keep was their producer, Caleb Southern, who produced the first album, and as Ben would put it, quote, he was the fourth Ben Folds 5 member, and after a long year of touring, Ben Folds came back to their shit house in 1996, where they would start recording their second album. And with only a few months to complete the project, Whatever and Ever Amen is being created.
Ben Folds 5, piano, bass, and drums. Three guys with no vision and a lot of money.
Ben wanted Whatever to be more than just the same old punk rock for sissies routine. He wanted to be more introspective and serious with their music, but they also wanted to keep what they were most known for, same silly and fun songs. And they ultimately decided on just doing a mix of all of them, side by side, with songs like Song for the Dump, a funny song that screams, "Give me my money back, you bitch."
Give me my money back, you bitch.
Right next to A Brick, a song about abortion. Ben said in his book, A Dream About Lightning Bugs, quote, "It was an honest snapshot of where we were. Half the album represented our time on tour, slogging it out in drunken rock clubs. The other half, the ballads, was new. It came from introspection inspired by travel and changes in life, end quote. Local fans who were listening to them play didn't really like where the band was going and thought that they were selling out because they started to play ballads. Ben Folds probably didn't care about this or didn't listen because the album kept those ballads. It's pretty funny to know that Ben Folds didn't think Brick would actually be a hit compared to his other singles that were released. He was wrong, but that doesn't mean that it wasn't a wild trip for that to actually become a reality.
Look, man, I got your hidden track right here, pal. Right here, listen. Ben Folds is a fucking asshole.
And now we're back in 1997, the year that Whatever and Never Amen released. Now that you're mostly caught up on what's the most important parts, let's continue with what we were really here for. On March 18th, 1997, Ben Folds 5 released Whatever and Ever Amen, One Angry Dwarf and 200 Solomon Faces, and Battle of Who Could Care Less, received moderate radio play on modern rock radio, but they weren't really game changers for BFF. And in the summer of that year, they would try their hand with Brick, like they did with the other songs. Modern rock stations weren't really used to playing any piano ballads, but they were willing to give it a try. The listeners, however, weren't very enthusiastic with this decision, and Brick was cut off the radio weeks later. Brick received lukewarm reception, and the label started to blame themselves for releasing it at a bad time. Sony 505 would tell Ben Folds 5 to take 1 month break while they figured out what they should do next, because they didn't receive any radio play anymore. This is where Ben Folds would start working on his experimental album, Fear of Pop, which is a great album if you enjoy something different from the normal Ben Folds sound that most people are familiar with, and William Shatner also appears on the album. Anyways, I wanted to delve a little deeper into Brick and why the song failed while it was being released the first time. Brick was a real story of the time Ben Folds actually had to get an abortion. This was a huge part of Ben's life and actually caused him to miss almost all of his last year of high school. The whole story is crazy and the song really shows what Ben was feeling at the time. As for why the song failed initially, I think it was due to what Sony really said. It was just a bad time and no one really wants to hear that type of music during the summer. People were really looking for something else and that's why it failed. Which brings me back to the story.
You know, I'm a little embarrassed to say this, but I know how to break dance, and I'm gonna do it right now.
Sony decided that they would wait to play the song during the colder season. They re-released the single as if it never happened in the first place. This decision would change the album, and finally, it became a hit with audiences. People couldn't get enough of it, and that was exactly what Sony wanted to see. Without the success, the whole record would have flopped. Ben Folds 5 wouldn't have gotten any further than they did, and who knows what would have happened. Ben Folds 5 was on top of the world, and nothing could stop them. Their concerts were selling out, people were going to keep riding on the hype train, and in my eyes, they really hit their peak on November 8th. That was the day that their most revered and important broadcast ever happened. Sessions at West 54th. This was the exact place that Nirvana recorded their MTV Unplugged performance only 4 years prior.
Coming up next, it's Sessions at West 54th.
If you've seen these guys before, then you're a fan. If you haven't, you're about to be. Ben Folds 5.
Ben Folds would later say about that concert, quote, "I walked in thinking, this is the one I leave behind, because it felt like some kind of time capsule gig," end quote. On November 9th of that same year, Ben Folds 5 would debut Brick's music video on MTV's 120 Minutes. After a lot more touring, Ben Folds 5 was told by their manager that they were invited to play on SNL. This, of course, would be their biggest performance yet, and in Ben Folds' eyes, this was his most important performance ever. It would cause the album to grow even more buzz than it already had. And on January 10th, 1998, they would perform Brick live.
We have a great show for you tonight. Ben Folds 5 is here.
When they finally got around to playing, Ben Folds recalled it as one of the worst performances of his whole career. The whole performance was a mess, and he knew it. He thought that there was no way to recover what he had already done. He started to freak out, and many people who he knew called him to ask if he was okay after the SNL performance. Ben Folds 5 was ashamed and started to think that they would only be remembered for one thing, and in a way, he was kind of right. He didn't see Brick as that one song that was supposed to be the savior for this band. After this performance, he would fly out to Australia to clear his mind. The following year, in 1999, they would release their album, The Unauthorized Biography of Reinhold Messner. It too was a commercial failure. Sometime in the year 2000, Ben Folds 5 would split. We wouldn't hear from the band until much, much later. And yeah, that's about all there is to the history of the second album. Of course, they've released other albums, but I want to talk about those later and just delve deeper into this at a different time. But anyways, I think it's crazy to believe that I came across this album in the first place. The only reason I got into Ben Folds and Ben Folds 5 was because I was watching Over the Hedge. And I decided to Shazam one of the songs off the album. And it just brought me through this whole entire wild journey that has started since my middle school years. Ben Folds 5 got me through high school and middle school. Whatever and Ever Amen was the first album I ever heard from them. I fell in love instantly. I could relate to the many themes in the music and thought it was smart, funny, and all around amazing. I believe that Ben Folds and Darren Jesse are some of the greatest writers that I've ever seen. They've written some of the most incredible songs I've ever heard, and also kind of funny. Also, small note, I think that Robert Sledge is one of the most underrated bass players of all time. I think he doesn't get enough credit for his playing ability. People should go back and listen to a lot of the bass lines, because a lot of Ben Folds' albums and songs really, really need that bass, and it matters so much to the song. And sometimes it feels like the bass is the most important. I mean, it is the most important part, but I'm talking about like the most, like the piano is just second, you know. It's just like Robert is the lead. It's kind of weird. Anyways, whether it was Smoke, a song that recalls a dead relationship that once was and uses a book as a metaphor, Battle of Who Could Care Less, which commented on the 90s and how nobody cared, or Missing the War, a song which says it was recorded live in New York, which I still doubt to this day because it just sounds like a studio recording that they did in a real studio. Which could be it, because I remember reading about how hard it was for them to really record that song in the shitbox, but I could be wrong. Probably really wrong. All these songs and many more were just some of the most enjoyable tracks I've ever heard, and that's not to mention all the bonus tracks that they added, like Air from Godzilla's soundtrack, or Mitchellane, which is my favorite song and the most relatable song I've ever heard. I know how it feels to be stuck in the same city of my whole entire life, so I just relate to this too much. Anyways, I think that Whatever and Ever Amen is more than just Brick. It always was. I just don't think that it appealed to too many people at the time. But now is a different time, and maybe it could appeal to different people, but who knows, it's just times have changed, and this album has a certain feel to it that most albums do not have, and it has a certain quality that just resonates with the whole entire shitty, untuned piano feel, like the first album. It has just a raw and great, fun, exciting, and just sad feeling to it. The next time you go to your local record store, or you go on eBay, and you see a copy of Whatever Endeavor Amen, I want you to look at it. Maybe even give it a shot. It really did change my life, and my view on the whole entire spectrum of music. And I mean, you know, you never know, this album could change your own life like it did to me. And it doesn't hurt to try, at least. I mean, the album's pretty cheap, I'm just gonna say that. And that's why you should give it a try. I mean, at least give the copy another life. That's what it deserves, at the very least. For around 3 years, I've been working and contemplating on this project. I always backed out of this project because I knew how much of a task it would bring at the time, and I wasn't capable enough to make this video, especially because my editing software was very limited. It wasn't until recently that I got in contact with Robert Sledge of Ben Folds 5. This is where I told him that I was working on a video about Ben Folds 5, and he told me that he was gonna see the video. I just knew that I had to make it. So, it really motivated me to actually work on this video and make it a reality. At first, I wanted it to be about the whole band's history. But when I finished writing the first page of the script, it sadly got corrupted. And this made me super unmotivated, and I gave up. That's when I just stopped working on the video altogether and just did whatever else I did. However, something sparked in my brain, and I found out that the 25th anniversary of the second album was going to be happening very soon, and I knew that I had to make a video about my favorite album of all time. Well, one of my favorites. I knew that I couldn't mess this up, so I got to work, and this is where I am now. Of course, I had to stay up really late to do this, but I think it's worth the wait, and I think it was worth a lot of the effort, because it's not just going to be the only thing I'm working on for Ben Folds 5. Of course, I missed some important information about the band and the making of the album, but it can't all be perfect, and of course it's going to have some hiccups and whatnot. But as long as it's perfect in my eyes, I think that's enough for me. Of course, I will be working on a full video eventually. And also expect a Sessions at West 54th video, because seriously, no one talks about that anymore, I swear. I'd like to end this video with a quote on one of Ben Folds 5's most memorable photo shoots on Spin Magazine. Yeah, the one on Mars or whatever. Ben had this to say about the music he creates for Ben Folds 5. If historians look back and blame us for dismantling the alternative genre, I wouldn't be ashamed at all. Well, sometimes I punch myself hard as I can. Yeah, thanks for watching. Hoping someone will tell me how old I am.
You gonna stick around and watch Ben Folds 5?
Yes, absolutely.
Have you heard the song Brick? It's huge. It's all over the radio. We're playing the video for it. Ben Folds 5 is still coming up with their song Brick. Don't leave now, you'd be a fool. MTV Live's coming up. These are beautiful.
Thank you.
drums? What about the other two? Ben Folds 5, whatever and ever, amen.